This Guitar Interactive feature is brought to you by Fractal Audio Systems.
You know, it's funny because we didn't really even think about a greatest hits. And then our record label said, you know, it's been 10 years since Universal put out the greatest hits. Mm. And we kind of went, oh, that's crazy. And they were like, and you guys have had hits since then. And, you know, it's like, so it's time. And we go, okay, yeah, okay. And then we started looking at all the songs and we thought, oh yeah, okay, this is solid. As far as like the remixes and that kind of stuff, well, the acoustic things were kind of easy. You know, we said we didn't want to just, we wanted to be special. We didn't want it to just compile the songs and then put them out, you know. And the remixes kind of came, I definitely think it was more of a no-brainer this time, only because we've been really kind of stepping out and working with some more of like the pop guys and the electronic guys, and
sure,
and mixing those worlds has been a little bit more normal for us lately. So it wasn't that foreign to us.
Yeah, no, I mean, it makes perfect sense to me. I mean, I think as you probably find, and we've spoken about this sort of briefly in the past, because you've always been a band, and you in particular, is somebody who's looking to what the latest things are, not following trends, but adopting things, whether it be yeah. technology or new music that's coming out. And you know, with this, it definitely feels like that. Did you feel sort of early on with it feels certainly that way in the last decade in particular, but did you ever feel like with some of the direction that you were taking with some of the music, and even this now with remixes where you are, you're involving, you know, like not on this particular record, but you are involving like TikTok star and all of that. Has there ever been any pushback from this that you find frustrating, or has that never been the case with Papa Roach fans?
We've always had pushback with everything that we've done since, you know, Infest or Love Hate Tragedy. It's just, well, this isn't you guys. This isn't you. This is, you need to go back to what you used to do and that kind of stuff. And we know that comes with the territory, and we're willing to do it. We're willing to put it out there. You know, we don't do this stuff because we think it's what people want.
No.
We do it because we're into it, and we know that it's going to piss some people off. But, you know, our perspective is that, especially for, well, the latest thing was the Last Resort Reloaded. You know, we got some pushback on that. And I always say, if you want something like the original, then just go listen to the original. It's still there. We didn't destroy it. It's not gone forever. You know, this is just something new
yeah.
that some people, you know, that we're into, that other people will like.
So that's and me personally, like, I didn't know the bloke, you know, but obviously I'm going to check it out when it's something new from Papa Roach, you know. And then I was like, well, yeah. shit, man, this is really, you know. And it's obviously great to hear, you know, not only is it really cool and the guy's got a cool voice, but it's nice to hear like the evolution of you guys performing it, because obviously we get to hear this live on shows and what have you, but it's yeah. nice to get an updated version of a classic track, especially when it's, you know, anniversary. Well, it's an anniversary, isn't it? 21.
Infest is old enough to drink in the US now.
That's absolutely. Now, as we mentioned there, you know, you are one that's definitely one for evolution in terms of your sound and stuff like that. But one thing that's been a constant throughout pretty much your whole career is this relationship with Schecter. You know, it's very rare not to see one of those in your hands, unless you maybe get a fly on the wall in the studio. You might pick up an odd Les Paul from time to time, I'm sure.
Yeah.
But you know, but just talk a little bit about that relationship with Schecter, and what was, you know, the thing early on that just turned you on to them?
So the thing that turned me on to them was, you know, before we got signed, we were doing like trips to LA, because where we live is about 7 hours drive from LA. So we would, you know, we still had our day jobs. We still would do our work and then, you know, do the band when we had time. We would sort of request time off, you know, and go do those trips. But in doing that, we would start making friends down there. And, you know, this one friend in particular named Brian Hara, he was in a band called Tura Satana, and we just made friends with them. He was a Schecter guy, and he introduced me to them. And you know, my first guitar was with them was that was still when they were only a custom shop. They didn't have any sort of factory guitars. So, you know, I ordered that one. It wasn't cheap, but it was an awesome guitar. And then they said, you know, if you want to do this, we're good to go with you guys. You know, we'll give you the artist deal and this and that. And then the record blew up, and you know, I got my own signature, and then ever since then they've given me everything I wanted. You know, we've done different series of signature guitars, and they've just been great to me. And you know, the guitars sound great and they feel great, and I have no reason to go anywhere else.
No, it makes perfect sense. It always, you know, when you see a picture of you, you know, it's very rare not to see you with one of those, especially your signature model and your hands. I mean, you know, with the Schecter guitars and the signature model, I mean, what was the, you know, the development of the signature model itself? Like, did you find that came together quite quickly at that stage? You know, did you know, I know I want this, I want that, or has that evolved over time?
It's changed here and there. In the beginning, it was the same shape that I was using. And then, you know, we just experimented with different pickup combinations, and we said, yeah, I like this hardware. I like these pickups, and let's do it this paint scheme. And there you go. And they said, yeah, let's do it. And at first we did, I think, black, gray, and white. And then later on we added the red. And over the years, you know, I've changed body shapes and changed pickup configurations. And kind of what sounds have suited the style of, you know, whatever current record we were on. And it's funny because I go back and we did that live stream, the Infest live stream.
Sure.
And I brought this thing back out, and the pickup combination having I think it was like a jazz pickup in the neck. It's like, I forgot how clear and sparkly it was, and it kind of made me want to change things up again.
Interesting. So, okay, how long had it been since I had been back out?
Well, I did take it out a couple of years ago. But I didn't really use the clean. It was just kind of like the song that I would, or the guitar I would bring out for like last resort or something. But then when we did the live stream, we were just jamming around and playing with it, and just started messing with it, and it was cool. It was like I said, it made me want to change it up a little bit.
Yeah, no, and I mean, you know, another thing that, you know, I've always been aware of with yourself is, you know, you're a very sort of early adopter to the digital technology and certainly taking that out live. But you've had that balance. I mean, what I love about it as well is you've never been shy about sort of saying, oh, right, well, okay, this is good enough for right now, but I want it to be better because it's still not quite as good as I need it to be for the studio, for the convenience factor. And you've been very honest about that, and you know what it is that you're after. How have you found, in the last sort of 4 or 5 years, the way that things like the Axe FX, the Kemper, just the digital modeling sort of technology has improved? And has it got to the stage now where when you get to the studio, you think, you know what, I've got all the sounds I need here, rather than using your Marshalls or Bogners or whatever it is that you'd be using?
I want to say that it's moved on, a crazy amount since the first time I started using it. But I think that this, with the new stuff that we're doing, it's probably 95% there.
Wow.
And we're still using amps in the studio. Mm-hmm. And it's probably not something that most people could pick up on. But for the people who know, for people who make music and record music, and the fans that are really detail oriented, those people will definitely pick up on it. There's just some, the quality of the air moving and the kind of the natural, I don't want to say room sound, but kind of.
So are you thinking about that more from a sonic perspective, or is it the feel that's a little bit different?
No, it's more for sonics.
Okay.
Because in the studio, everything is so isolated. It's that part of it, the feel part of it, doesn't really come into it as much. I guess I could be in the same room, but it's just the feedback is, it's really difficult in the studio. Anyway, it's just it's one of those things where it's, like I said, most people wouldn't really get it. They wouldn't tell the difference. And we have actually, even on previous records, we've used, Fear was mostly, we used the Kemper, but, those songs were so saturated, with instruments and that you couldn't really pick out those small details. But, we're on this stuff, we're kind of focusing on having space in certain places and having dynamics and where you can hear that, they say the space is just as important as the note.
Well, that's it. And I guess it's, as you said, the majority of people or some people might not be able to pick out these bits and pieces, but for somebody like yourself, a great songwriter, it's these small percentages that are the difference between the inspiration some of the time, isn't it? And I suppose if you're playing through that gear, you're like, the song was in there, you want to get that down. And then after the fact, when it's a live show, that's a whole different animal, isn't it? So, totally. And I guess sometimes when it's mic'd up a certain way coming through the PA, you end up with a slightly different sound than maybe what's on the stage anyway. So that can be the thing. What is your, because I know you have used Axe FX quite a bit, and you mentioned the Kemper. What's your sort of go-to for digital right now? What's the number one thing that if you've got to choose the one?
It's Axe FX 3. That's what I'm using, and it goes straight to the board. I would eventually like to add a cabinet for monitoring, you know, we have the side fills and that works, but I don't know that, I just feel like it would be for me better to have a dedicated thing to kind of bring back some of that feel from, you know, cause back in the day when I was using the Marshall stuff, it was just like, you know, I had four cabinets all running and I miss that sometimes. So, you know, having it in the side fills is cool, but having a dedicated cabinet, it's just hard to replace that.
Mm-hmm. No, was that what you, did you use Axe FX on the live stream?
I did.
Yeah, I mean, it sounded absolutely killer. I mean, what a fantastic performance.
Yeah, it was thick and it was cool. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, for live, it's awesome. And mostly for studio, it's great too, but like I said,
yeah, no,
5%.
Absolutely. And, you know, with last year, you know, you were robbed there of having that great 20th anniversary of Infest, you know, I'm assuming everything needed to be postponed a little bit, but will you take that show out on the road when, you know, it's viable again and maybe play the record in full?
That's a good question. I don't know. I don't know if we would be, I mean, I think when we're able to tour again, I think we'll have new stuff by then. Mm-hmm. We have a lot of new stuff in the can. We're just kind of getting, you know, we're still writing and we just want to take advantage of the time and get the best of the best that we can. And I think by the time that we get on tour, we'll want to focus on that.
Yeah.
But I think that we'll eventually do that tour. I just don't know how, involved it will be, how extensive it will be.
Well, 25 is a good number as well, isn't it?
So that's true. Yeah, we could do that. we may end up doing a couple of shows. I know the hardcore fans are really wanting us to do Love, Hate, Tragedy, especially because we haven't really played many songs from that record.
Yeah.
So
why is that, by the way, just out of interest? Because I know, you know, I mean, it's an absolute killer record and there's got to be some of your favorites on there. Why is that's never really been one that's made much of the set list?
I hate to throw him under the bus, but Jacoby just doesn't want to do it. Yeah, I think that, right. I feel like it was kind of a dark time for him personally and maybe some memories or something that he just doesn't want to revisit. But personally, I really love a lot of the songs on that record. And I know a lot of our hardcore fans, some of them actually like that record more than Infest. And every time we come around, you know, I get at least a couple of people saying, Why not any from Love, Hate, Tragedy? So
it's what it is, I guess. Well, hopefully, you know, everyone's in touch wood, everyone's in a great place at the moment. And, you know, these demons, whatever they are, you know, it's like, well, long time ago, and it's great music. But I mean, that's undeniable. But you're right. I feel with that record. I mean, personally, I feel like it's an underrated record, massively. But yeah, amongst Papa Roach fans, everyone knows. But it's I wondered if the reason that maybe some of those tracks didn't get played was one of those ones, you know, like treat them mean, keep them keen kind of situation, you know, like the one, you know, eventually we'll play it, but it's a shame to know that there's maybe some sadness behind it, but hopefully, you know, we will get to hear more. You did mention there that you know, you're already thinking of the next thing. And of course, that's the thing today, you know, you put out a record, you've got your greatest hits here, you've got some new music on there for people to hear, or new versions of them for people to hear. But the next thing is like, when are we going to get to hear a new album? Now, you just had a fantastic record out in 2019. 2020 was a write-off. When do you think realistically we will see a new record?
We're deciding right now on a time frame. You know, I think that we would love to get something out soon, but especially for rock bands, I feel like the music needs to go out in tandem with a tour. So we may wait until we can, you know, we may wait for album release until we can get out on tour. Luckily we have this and, you know, the greatest hits. And then also we have some reimaginings in the works, some collaborations with some other people for, some more of the older stuff, which we're pretty excited about. And, we could release, you know, in the coming year. So yeah, I know I didn't really answer your question, but
it sounds like there's some things in there that you can't talk about just yet. I'm assuming that's the case.
I mean, we're, like I said, we would like to get stuff out this, you know, sometime this year, but realistically it could be the end of the year, possibly first of next year.
And these collaborations that we're going to get to hear, you know, relatively soon, are they going to be surprising names on there, or some that we may expect?
I think they'll mostly be a surprise.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah.
You're pleased with them, yeah? You look like you are.
Yeah. Yeah. It's coming together and we're super stoked about it.
Fantastic. That'll be really exciting to see. Something I just want to pick your brain on, because, you know, it is hard to believe. You certainly don't look it, but, you know, as a band that's been going almost 30 years, I mean, it's incredible. It's the early 90s. You've been involved in the music in some shape or form for the majority of your life. These days, we're seeing a lot of the bigger artists selling off the rights to the music, to the labels and various different things, and Spotify streaming and debates over different things. How do you feel about that from a personal perspective? You know, like, do you feel positive about the way music is going to be delivered in the future? And what do you make of that about some of these sort of massive artists that we've all grown up loving, sort of deciding it's time to cash out?
I can't speak for what everybody else is doing. I think that, you know, you never know what somebody's financial situation is. So, you know, it could be a case of taking some of that money and investing it. And, you know, I don't think that necessarily people that are selling their catalogs are really calling it quits. You know, it's just probably just a cash flow thing. I think, you know, for us, you know, we're still in it. We still own our stuff. And, you know, the focus for us is to really just keep putting out new music, you know, and we actually are our own label now. So it's kind of scary, and it's also kind of liberating at the same time. You know, it's something that will definitely give us more control, but it'll increase the responsibility for us. So that part of it is, it's a little scary. But I think that, as far as like the streaming, it would be great for the streaming shares to be a little more fair, but you know, we don't really have control over it. It's one of those things where, you know, if a group of people, like a group of artists get together and really like pound the pavement, you know, we'll definitely get in there. But it's going to take a whole community of people really, I think, to bring that type of change around. You know, we do like the fact that our music can get into the hands of everybody. And then, you know, we'll also find ways to really, service the hardcore fans and, you know, the diehard people that have been with us forever and want to be involved with the band on more than just casually listening to the music.
Mm-hmm. Well, look, congratulations on the Better Noise years. Can't wait for the days where you can get back to the UK again and we'll get to see you live. Yep. And keep yourself safe out there, okay?
Yes, sir. Awesome. Thank you so much.
Thanks, mate. Bye-bye.
All right. Bye.